So, let's talk about the different parts of the brain and what they do. Parts of the brain are functionalized for different purposes that do different things, which is who damage to different parts of the brain has different effects. It's who when you look at an fMRI scan or PET scan or something that records neural activity. You could figure out basis of the election or the activity was going on. So, that's first things to realize is I am talking about the brain, but it may be more big and more inclusive if I talk about the brain and parts of the spinal cord. So, you don't need your brain for everything. There certain activities we do that can happen without a brain, like sucking in newborns or pulling your limb back to withdraw from pain or vomiting. But for everything else I talk about in this course, we'll really be talking about the brain. So, some of the structures of the brain that are highly relevant are headed subcortical, which means that they're below the cortex, which means they're in the center of the brain. This includes part of the brain like the amygdala, which control certain automatic function you like your heart rate, your blood pressure, swallowing, and so on. It includes the cerebellum, we've involved in body balance and musical coordination. It contains about 13 billion neurons. So this is in small patterns. The hypothalamus, which is involved in feeding and sex and thirst and different appetites. We're going to talk about emotions or visceral discourse. We'll return to those parts of the brain, but for aspect of psychology that are destructive for use, that makes us human, we mostly focused on the outlier, the cerebral cortex. So the cerebral cortex, it is all crumpled up. If you were to take brown, pull out the cortex and stretching it out, like you're among a ride you got from the thing of your car, and you have stretched it out. It's about to fit square. So, it's a lot of crumbling to get in. It's about the millimeters thing. This is where the action is. This is where it lasts for the things I am interested in. This is where it takes place. It's where reasoning and language and complex perceptions comes from. Fish don't have any cerebral cortex. Reptiles and birds have a little bit, but primates, including humans, have a lot. When you look at the cortex, you'll see it in house two halves. It has left half and right half. For each of those halves, when you look at it, you can demarcate the brain, the cortex, into different lobes. They're going from your forehead and sweeping to the back. You have the frontal lobe, conventionally announced on the front, the parietal lobe, the occipital lobe, and the temporal lobe. Each of those lobes, there's different things which we'll talk about in a bit. Another thing about the cortex thought which is super interesting is that it includes pups. What I mean by this is it includes topographical maps where two things that are close together in the brain are similarly close together in the body. So there is matter where if you were to choke parts of the brain, parts of the body would twitch accordingly. just like you'd expect, the middle finger is close to the thumb, which is closer to elbow. If it's close in the real world and your body is close to the brain, and there's a primary somatosensory, which is the sensory organs. Then if you have somebody in the operating table and you shock at people, they will experience things. They might experience a sound or a flash of light or a touch. In fact, in the occipital lobe, you have a map for vision, and in the temporal lobe, you have a map for sound. What's really cool is, I said the map is topographical, but the size of the brain arms don't correspond to the size of the actual body arms, but rather to the extent to which the motor or sensory function. So after artists have drawn pictures of people if their body was proportional to the extent that their brain was, you see the shrink of the body is relatively small, but the hands are enormous and the face is enormous, because those whole lot of sensation. There is much more sensation going in your hand than in your whole back, even though the back is physically apart. So part of the cortex is those projection arms, but less than a quarter of the cortex contains projection arms. As I said, the rest is involved with the cool stuff, with language, with reasons, with moral thoughts, and so on. Then the questions sum in, how do you know this? How do you know what parts of the brain do what? What parts of the brain are involved and who? Those different answers. So, one answer is, we can scan the brain. We can use MRI, which is a high frequency magnetic field, to look at the activity of the brain. Which parts are active when people do different things. We can also look so-called natural experiments when people have tumors or strokes or motorical accidents. In damaged part of your brain, and we can ask the questions, which damage to which parts of the brain corresponds to damage to which functions. Through these different methods, we've learned about the different parts of the brain and what they do. We could talk about some certain specific things that can go on due to brain damage or stroke or trauma. So, for instance, there's expraxia. Expraxia is problems of actions, so you're unable to do an action. Like waving goodbye or picking up before on car can bring some food to your mouth. You're not paralyzed. We can make the movements if you have to, but you can't coordinate those basic movements into complex actions. There's agnosia. Agnosia is a disorientation of perception, and they not like you can see, but you can recognize. Some is called physical blindness. People of various form of agnosia can describe a picture in terms of its parts, but can recognize the objects that are being depicted. That's from a visual agnosia. There are also specific prosopagnosia, where you can't recognize faces. Oliver Sacks wrote a wonderful book many years ago called The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Head. This was a series of profiles of people who had a separation neurological disorders, and the title case of the book was a man who actually had such an inability to recognize faces. He could just distinguish his wife's face from that of a head. Multiple forms of prosopagnosia, which some people suffer from, and to be honest, I got a little bit of some terrible faces. Is that you could recognize the faces as faces, but you can't recognize whose those faces there are, and it's very hard of you to recognize the people. There's problems of sensory negligence. You get disorders that block out one part of the world. You might have damage to parts of your brain that will block out the left side of the world. It's not just the social physical thing. When you ask somebody with such a discredit to draw a clock, for instance, they put all the numbers for 1 to 12 on the right side of the clock. Is as if they don't think on the left side of the world again. So maybe it's not even a sensory problem, but an intentional problem. There's aphasia, which refers to disorders of language. Some forms of aphasia are expressive, like a broken aphasia where you can't really speak. A famous case of somebody who can only use the word 10 would say 10, 10, 10, but can't say anything else. Oh, then there's something that called accepted aphasia, where you can speak a thought that you say doesn't make much sense, but also you have a terrible time understanding other people. Then there's all sorts of the other disorders. Those are the disorders which we talk about with regard to Phineas Gage and various forms of it. The domain to your brain is debatable whether this is Phineas Gage, but there are other cases where it's much more clear. Case you to lose your moral sense, your sense for right and wrong, your ability to control yourself, to restrain yourself, hears your conscience. Now we are going to talk about all of those things thought the cause, but the moral here is that there are some localization of functions. There's some sense in which it corresponds to different brain areas. And B, again, this is an argument against dualism. We can see that anyone who argued that the means isn't their brain would be hard-pressed to explain how damage to the brain seems to affect some very intimate and very important aspect of ourselves.